So our next concept in chapter two is purposefulness, talking about the purposefulness that humans feel when they're doing their jobs. They have a purpose, and if you don't, if humans don't have a feeling of purposefulness, then they don't typically are not very happy at their job. You're not required to be happy all the time at your job, but if you don't have a purpose, you're like, what the heck? Why am I doing this? I should just go do something else, and then it happens. So in the idea of purposefulness, like why are you doing what you're doing, something from the text is the world is not run by those who are right. So maybe you're not always doing what is the right thing to do. Maybe you're doing what you were told, or maybe you were doing what you thought you should be doing. But it is run by those who can convince others that they are right. And so this is sort of the importance of influencing people. Hopefully you influence them and you're a good influence. We all know Star Wars, there's the light side and the dark side of the Force, so you can also be a bad influence for somebody. But the idea is typically, whether it's peer pressure or whether it's leadership, you're typically influencing others to follow you or to follow your lead or to follow your idea or to follow or adopt your purpose. So it turns out that we'd like to have people not only be aware that they need to follow their own purpose, but we need people to sort of lead others and say, hey, here's the right way to go. We should do this. So again, just because you might think, well, I guess they're doing the right thing because people always do the right thing. That's not the case. The people do what other people inspire them to do. So if it's your turn to inspire somebody to do the right thing or do what you think is expedient, then that's what you should be up to. So yeah, these humans have choice. So we get a chance to decide what we want to do. And choice has three aspects according to our author. The first aspect is a rational choice. This is usually in the case of self-interest, the idea of hey, what's best for me? How does this work? If I pull back here again, so we had just talked about the tragedy of the commons in the first chapter, the problem with rational thought, even though it may be the correct thing to do, for that person. If we saw in the tragedy of the commons, you remember, a fisher, one of the men in the parable, taking two or three fish every day rather than just one. Self-interest wise, that makes sense, but overall, it was a bad idea. So humans have a choice. There's rational, self-interest. There's emotional, which things get excited, and this is why we have marketing majors and marketing departments. This is why we run commercials. It's why we have memes on social media. This is to get people excited about doing something. This is why we have campaigns. This is why we have awareness campaigns. It's why we have product launch campaigns. It's why we happen to have songs. We have trailers for movies. The idea is to get people excited about what's coming up. And then you want to sort of, if they're excited and they're happy and they think this is going to be cool, you can emotionally get them to do what you've convinced them is the right thing to do. Hey, I think you should go to the movies after COVID is over. I think you should go to the movies, and I think you should drop $15 a ticket in this really, really special theater with all kinds of Dolby surround and really, really cool seats and watch this movie. And then later on, you find out where it wasn't very good. But it had a fantastic advertising campaign to get people into the theaters. So, but our third one, so rational is what's sort of the best thing for everybody to do. It may not be the best thing for everyone as a system, but it's the best thing for individuals to do. There's the emotional, or there's the excitement, and then there's sort of the default. If someone is not doing things for their rational self-interest, if they're not being influenced by some sort of commercial, then they just sort of are on autopilot and do things by default. Like, I'm not even really sure why I did that. It was in the morning, so I had cereal. You know, without getting excited, I just grabbed what was there. So again, just a little more in depth. I sort of mentioned this already. The rational choice is risk adverse. It's usually safe. It's usually benefits you the most, but unfortunately, it may lead to tragedy of the commons, as we saw before. Emotional choice is it usually involves risk. Like, hey, this is exciting. maybe this will be a really great movie. Maybe this will really be a sucky movie, but at least we're going to try. We're going to give it a shot. Maybe this would be a really great thing to do, spending in our weekend. I've never been horse riding before. Maybe it'll be fun. Maybe it'll be horrible. I'm not really sure. But again, that's why we have people who are making fantastic careers inside marketing and sales, because they'd like to convince humans who are going to purchase their stuff to make an emotional choice. And then, of course, we have the cultural choice. This is the instinct, if you will. This is non-thinking. You know, why did you tie your shoe that way? Well, I guess I learned to tie my shoe in kindergarten, and now I always do that. Or why do you stop at Wawa on the way in the morning when right next door Dunkin' Donuts is having free coffee? Well, I always stop at this Wawa. It's just sort of what I do. So it's sort of cultural choices you go through. So if we're going to be making change, if we find out that the system needs to change because the game has changed, we have these three levers to pull, if you will. We can try to change culture and try to get people to do things differently. Obviously, we're going to be doing a lot of things differently now that we've all been through COVID. If you have been outside and you have been to Wawa or you've been to the store because we need to buy things, you'll notice they have distancing markers on the floor. They have sneeze guards and breathe guards at the register. Maybe they're going to be permanent. Maybe they're always going to be there. Maybe that will help people not to get the flu or not to get people cold, give people colds. Maybe we'll be a much healthier society now that we have that. For all of you, if you've ridden on a plane, you've never been on an airplane without going through TSA security. We didn't have TSA security. The TSA didn't exist before 9/11 back in 2001. And back in the 70s, we didn't have safety seals on things that you bought at the store. It sounds kind of gross now, but if you wanted to buy a jar of mayonnaise, you could walk up to the mayonnaise. It had a lid on it, but you could pop the lid on and smell it and see how it worked. There was no safety seal underneath it until, of course, some goofball put some cyanide in a bottle of Tylenol and started killing people. So usually there is a bad thing that happens, and then we adjust because of it. And then all of these choices have to change, and people have to change how they do things. So we'll be definitely making lots of changes of how we do things after COVID. The idea of purposefulness, again, maybe there's things that we really do need to change. The idea is that the realities of, well, we can't do that, or that's too hard, or we're never going to change. Well, it's never going to happen until someone's willing to challenge what we're doing. So we're going to need a lot of leadership in that case, especially with COVID. In the case of choice, giving humans a choice, it implies competence. It implies that humans are educated enough to make a good choice, whether it's rational or emotional or cultural. If they really don't know what the appropriate choice is, or know the facts to make the appropriate choice, then they don't really have the power to do. This is sort of the idea of why, if you have a young sibling or a young nephew or niece, and it's time for them to cross the road, you're usually going to say, "Hey, hold my hand. I'm the bigger person here, and I'm going to know because I've been trained. I'm going to know when it's safe to cross the road rather than just letting you go whenever you want to go." So we don't let children cross the road by themselves because we haven't sort of certified them to be cross the road certified. Same thing here when we ask adults to do things at in businesses and maybe even in research. We have to be certified to do certain things, which is of course why we have undergraduate education and why we're searching to get a Bachelor of Science degree in a topic. It certifies people and lets people know that you have the competence to make the right choice. Along the lines of that, this idea of liberty, we're in Philadelphia, we're the cradle of liberty. Liberty without competence is nothing. If you give everybody freedom of choice and say, "Hey, do whatever you want," and people aren't really sure what the best thing is to do, it's nothing, and the system will fall apart. So this, we need to gain competence through learning and experience of the individuals as they go through. So this idea of why is purpose important and how do we change things, this is a nice message from Kid President. It's been around for a while. Perhaps you've seen it. We're going to take a look at this and see what you have to think about it.